I'm told it seems a lie that I might clear the sky. And the light from that old light will save me on. If it wasn't for that old light, my ship would sail no more. And I thank God for the light I owe my life to Him. For Jesus is light out, and from the rocks of sin He has shone His light. If it wasn't for my house, where would it should be? Come on, Greg. And I felt like he was telling me last night that the relationship that I have with Christ is all him. It's his relationship with me. That I have to submit myself to him, and he makes the relationship. What part of this is me? He's done it all. Amen? Amen. Jesus did it all. Not me. All right, Brad.
Thank you.
This is the Lord's doing. On a day like this, I'm feeling so blessed. I'll be walking where I call my home. I'll be safe and sound. Heaven, I'll be found.
Thank you.
But there's power. That's what happened. There's power. I'm going to do sing me to heaven when it comes my time to go. Gather round me, friends, and sing me sad faces, just all my friends, red song. Take me to heaven when I'm gone. We're all just taking time on gathering. It's all my favorite song. Thank me, heaven, when I'm when it comes my time to go. Gather round me, friend, send me home. No sad faces, just all this time. I feel like I have one Easter song that God gave me, and I was years ago, I guess when that movie came out, Passion of Christ, I didn't really want to see it. Anybody agree with me that just watching my Lord and Savior get beat to death is just not something I really want to see every day? And but you know, I felt like the Holy Spirit really, so we went and bought did whatever it was, a disc, I guess. And we're living in the bus back then, and I remember watching it. I got so angry. I got so angry at all people. Quit beating on my Lord and Savior. I felt like, you know, you think you're on the right side when you say that, right? But I felt the Holy Spirit telling me, well, you're no better if you're thinking that. If you're hating these people for beating on me, you're just as bad as they are. And I'm like, man, that's just... And I walked to the back of the bus and I wrote the song. And Larry stood without saying a word, laughed at him and how they cursed at the sight of him. How could they not see? His face is bruised, his skin is torn, and on his head, a crown of thorns. And when he died, Mother Mary cried. He's coming back to see. His price had he paid for our sins. He's coming back to see us again. And this time will be over, my friend. Thank you. She's standing back there, she did not see this coming, and that's why I had to get her up here. Because I'm a little bit rebellious. I don't know, I like the fucking kind of thing. One thing we never did is a birthday song today while they're thinking about the song. Eight birthdays this morning? We got a church full of people and not a single birthday. How do you like that? This is a miracle. It's Carolyn's birthday again. She gets one about every 2 months. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to whoever you are. Happy birthday to you. Thank you.
Kids church, go on out and enjoy yourselves. God is good, huh? Well, we keep getting more and more folks all the time, and I keep thinking, what are we going to do? And I think the Lord's telling me that the music doesn't run them off. I'm guessing the sermon could. It's interesting that God had been, you know, he's been dealing with me here through this season tremendously, and especially asking me certain questions, you know, even about myself and about my faith and about direction, different things. Has anybody ever, you know, asked God, like, where do we go from here? You know, I mean, I'm thinking, and then you have to think back, where did it all start and how did it all begin? Who was there? And I can tell you, none of y'all were there in the beginning. Okay. And it's very humbling to see so many folks that come out and want to honor God, especially on this day, you know. I know that this is not the biblical Passover, but we celebrate it now. It's a couple of 3 weeks from now, and understand that will happen too. But sometimes our Passover that we celebrate, it overlaps with the biblical Passover, and sometimes that's really cool when they come together. They didn't this year, so. I've been thinking a lot about this question that God had been asking me for the last couple of days. And it was, what really matters? I mean, when you think about it, we go through the motions, we do lots of stuff, and I know that the Lord is just he's an amazing God. He loves us so much that in this season, we think about what he really did for us. He gave the very best thing he had. He gave his only begotten Son that we might have life. Amen? An abundant life here on this earth and an everlasting life when we leave this place. I got to thinking when I'm thinking about what really matters. A lot of you know that Chaplain Gil Herring, who served in this church for over 10 years, has went on to be with the Lord this week. And what really interesting man, you know, did a lot in his lifetime. He worked in the nursing homes, you know, would go do services every week for year after year after year, him and Niecy. And I want to make sure that you keep Niecy in your prayers, and she's going to need a lot of support, a lot of encouragement. And as I was at his bedside the other day, I got to thinking, what really matters? What really mattered to him now? You know, there he was getting ready to be in the loving arms of his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And you can tell a lot about a man when he comes to the end of his life. Do you know that? Thinking about Jesus, and got me thinking about my dad, actually. My dad was an amazing father. He showed us and gave us so much love. Cared about us so much and his entire family. And he passed away at 51 years of age. And I could think on that weekend that he passed away, the important things that he had instilled in my life and showed me actually how to live life on this earth in a very simple way. he was profound, but he was a simple man. I'll never forget on his deathbed what he said. He quoted Ecclesiastes, and interesting verse there as he's taking his last breath. It was Ecclesiastes 4:12. And I don't know, do you have that verse? Though I may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. And as I thought about that, he was telling us the strength of Christ's unity, and the unity being a triple braided cord, one person and another person, and Jesus himself, Christ, making that cord not easily broken. Paul was interesting. I looked up a verse when I'm thinking about what really matters. Paul summed it up, and actually 1 Corinthians 15:3. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. That's what really matters, folks. I mean, we could quit right there. But what I thought about what was true of my father was even more true about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Consider the final words as he hung on the cross. Luke 23:34. There it is. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Wow. They were hurling insults, they were mocking this dying man. And what can be more hurtful than words? Maybe even you have felt hurtful words in your lifetime. Even loved ones do that sometimes. And I met a man the other day that was hurt by a loved one, and he was left wounded and bleeding. And I told him, I said, if you're suffering, there's a balm for this laceration. His name is Jesus. Everybody say Jesus.
Jesus.
And in one of his final acts, Jesus shows us how to react to others when we're hurt, when the anger of others comes against us. And here's Jesus. He didn't retaliate. He didn't bite back. And he didn't say, wait till after the resurrection, I'll get you. None of that stuff was on his lips. None of it. He did nothing. And these statements were not found on Christ's lips. And look at what he did do. He entrusted himself to him who judges justly, and he left the judging to God. And he even spoke on their defense. I mean, isn't that incredible? I mean, he's speaking on their defense. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I don't know about you, but it's amazing to me that he spoke on behalf of these heartless thugs. If anybody had a shot at revenge, it was Jesus, but he didn't take it. And when he prayed, Father, forgive them, guess what? He was praying for you and me too. And every person who has ever lived. And in his final hours, just like my dad, he got his house in order. His final words from the cross came in the form of forgiveness. And he left that offer. He left that offer of eternal grace for each and every one of us. And so I think he's saying here this morning, will you let Jesus forgive you? Will you let Jesus forgive you? And will you offer forgiveness to others? And this is a big part of the message of the cross. Your mind. The news of the day is spreading like wildfire. The Nazarene is being executed, and they say that one of his own has turned him in. And a few people weep, and others were smiling, and a few walk up the hill just to watch what was going on. And some are irritated that the sanctity of Passover is being violated by a bunch of social activists. Do you know that's what you're going to be turned? That's what God's turning us into right now. I want to tell you. Just fasten your seatbelt and get ready, because we're a social activist in this society today. Do not waver. Do not back down. And I think they were thinking, is this the same man who was celebrated with a road of palm fronds just a few days ago? We did it here last week. We waved him as the kids came in. And no matter what, you know, lives were touched on that day. And some of them by choice and others by chance. I got to reading last night about this Malachus, and he's a servant of the high priest, and he's only doing his job, and here he is, and Jesus is an arrest, and the arrest would have been his last one if he wouldn't have ducked. He ducked, and Peter's sword cuts off his ear. Peter gets rebuke, and guess what Malachus gets? He gets a miracle. Jesus reaches down and puts his ear back on. And some believe that Malachus was now numbered in the group of believers at Jerusalem. We don't know for sure. That's what some theologians say. But we can be sure of one thing. From that night on, when folks talked about this guy from Carpenter from Nazareth, well, I'll bet he'd reach and he'd tug on his ear and he'd say that nothing was impossible with this God. Reading this morning about Barnabas, a prisoner free, because one that he had never seen or he had never met took his place. And it's just my opinion, but Barnabas was probably smarter than we are in one respect. As far as we know, he took his freedom for what it was, an undeserved gift. He said, I'll take it. Somebody tossed him a life preserver. And he took it, no questions asked. Not like a lot of folks, not like some Christians. Often we take that gift and we try to earn it. And we try to diagnose it, we try to pay for it. Instead of saying, thank you, Lord, for the gift. Thank you for dying on a cross for me that I might have life. And just accepting it. Somebody say, thank you, Lord. It's ironic sometimes that it may seem one of the hardest things to do is to be saved by grace. You know that? It's one of the hardest things. There's something about us that reacts to God's free gift. And we have this weird compulsion that we have to create laws and we have to create systems and regulations that'll make us worthy of this gift that God gives us freely. Why do we do that? I don't know, but my best guess on that day that Jesus was crucified there and on that weekend and after he was resurrected and all those folks went home, I bet that weekend was spellbinding to them. And they went home with a story about this king who was raised from the dead. But I want to tell you, if I'm going to say anything today, you cannot leave this place and be in neutral on an issue like this. You cannot do that. You got to be on one side or the other. And you have to choose. You have to choose like they chose. They chose on that day. For every turncoat Judas, there was a faithful John. There's something about this crucifixion that made every witness either step toward the cross or step away from it. To step toward the tomb or step away from that tomb. And today, more than 2,000 years later, guess what? The same is true for each and every one of us. We either step toward it or we step away from it. Either you're all in or you're all out. I want to tell you what a choice is demanded. And it's like, y'all know what the continental divide is? Well, you be on one side or the other. When you walk out those doors, you're going to know that you're either on one side or you're on the other. The choice is demanded, and you can do what you want to with the cross. You can do what you want to, but you know, some of us look at the history, and some of us look at the theology, and some of us study, I mean, even prophecy. But one thing you cannot do, you cannot walk away in neutral. You cannot. There's no fence sitting on this issue. And we all have to answer the question that Jesus offered the crowd in the book of Matthew. I think it's Matthew 12:30. Here it is, right here. Anyone who isn't with me opposes me. And anyone who isn't working with me is actually working against me. Hello? We go, and when I think about this, as we go to the garden of the tomb of Jesus, I wonder what it would have been like to hear the words that the woman heard that first Easter morning, 28:5-6. The angel spoke to the woman, "Don't be afraid. I know that you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said it would happen. Come and see where the body is laid." Wow. "I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. He's risen from the dead, as he said he would." Early in the morning, John said something interesting. John said it was still dark. John 20:1. "Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found the stone that had been rolled away from the entrance." Dark. It had been dark since Friday. It was dark with Peter's denial. It was dark. And it was dark with all the religious leaders and their blindness. The only ember of light was a band of women standing at a distance. They were standing at a distance from the cross too. They were watching. Among them were two Marys. Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and Mary Magdalene, the other one, the other Mary. And I'm thinking, why are they there? They were the last to leave Calvary, and they were the first to arrive at the grave. You want something done, you get a woman. I said that for you, honey. And this morning promises them only one thing. They go down there on that morning, and it's an encounter with a corpse. Remember Mary and Mary. They don't know it's the first Easter. They have no idea what they're going to see. Well, they think that they're going to see a corpse when they get down there, just hoping to see one, so they can anoint the body. You see, we know something that they didn't know. Now, of course, we do. That the father was watching Mary and Mary, and they thought that they were alone, but they weren't alone. God knew, and God knew it. He had a surprise for him. The surprise comes in 28:2-4. Let's see. "Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear, and they, when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint." Well, here he is. The stone was moved for the woman. "Come and see the place where the Lord lay, or where his body was." But why did the angel move the stone? Well, did he move the stone for Jesus? Well, that's what I used to think. I used to think that all day. Did they move the stone for Jesus? Did God really have to have help? I don't think so. I don't think he did it. In fact, I believe Jesus was already out when the stone was moved. Listen to what the angel says in 5-6. "Then the angel spoke to the woman, 'Don't be afraid,' he said. 'I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He's risen from the dead, just as he said it would happen. Come see where the body was laying.'" The stone was moved for the women, not so Jesus could get out. And one more surprise awaits them in 9-10, the verses 9-10. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them saying, rejoice. Jesus met them. Another surprise along the way. So they came and they held him by the feet and they worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go tell my brethren to go to Galilee and there they will see me. Wow. Well, the God of surprises, he strikes again. And they had came so far to see him. They came so far to see me, I'm going to drop in on them. God does that. He'll drop in on you when you least expect it. Anybody had God drop on them? Drop right in on them? I know we have. These two women will never be the same. You know why? Because they never gave up. They never quit. You hear that all the time. Don't quit. Don't quit. Keep going. Keep moving forward. Put one foot in front of the other. And he's telling us this morning, don't quit. God is watching. For all we know, God might be telling angels to move the stone for you. Whatever's blocking the entrance to let you out and release you. Release the beast this morning. Don't give up. And because if you do give up, guess what? You might miss the answer to your prayers. You've been praying for a long time. Because guess what? God still sends angels and God still, he removes stones also. That's what he does. He's been doing it for a long time since the beginning of creation. He's been coming to our rescue. I want you this morning to think about two hills. Two hills that were climbed that weekend. Here we have Jesus on the hill of Calvary and Judas on the hill of regret. And Judas walked it alone. What motivated him to betray his master? And I got to thinking, it really doesn't matter. It matters not. Because the end result is always the same, is regret. He, like so many of us, we walk silently. We walk around silently with leg irons on. Leg irons of guilt. And we're often not even able to forgive ourselves. Paul, he was a man who posed the question that so many of us are asking in Romans 7:24. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Somebody say Jesus. At the trail's end, there are two trees. I seen this morning. One tree is weathered and it's leafless. It's dead, but it's still sturdy. And on one of the strongest branches of this dead tree is tied a hangman's noose. It was here for where Judas dealt with his failure. Just a few feet from the tree of despair is a tree of hope. Goodness within arm's reach of death. Right there. Here's death and here's goodness. A hangman's noose. And guess what the other one is? The other one's a life preserver. And they're so close to each other. So why does Jesus stand on a barren hill with his outstretched arms offering such a crazy holy grace? Why does he do that? The type of grace that just doesn't add up to logic. And to tell you the truth, I guess that grace is not logical anyhow. There's no logic to it. It doesn't have to be. And if it did, it wouldn't be grace. And it's offered to each and everybody in this place. Do you remember the question that I asked when we were at the beginning of the service? What really matters? And I think that's the question that we need to ask ourselves here right now, today, in this place. What really matters? The answer which lies at the core of our entire faith, all of Christian faith. And here it is. Christ died for our sins. Turn to your neighbor. Christ died for your sins. That's what he did. And that's what really matters for you, and that's what really matters for me. You know, there are people who come here today that have decided they want to get in the water, they want to be baptized. And when we leave out these doors today, we're going to go out there and we're going to lay hands on folks, we're going to pray for them, we'll ask them a couple of questions, and then we'll be baptized. It has been, God has moved on their heart to make this happen. And I believe that, you know, Phyllis and I, some years ago, we went to a wedding. And the wedding was so cool, it was so much fun. And after the wedding, they told us, they go into this room, and there'll be appetizers, and there'll be refreshments, and there'll be all kinds of things that you can have to enjoy yourself and enjoy the fellowship. And we went into that room, and we had fellowship, and we had appetizers, and we had drinks and different things. And I'll never forget, people were leaving then. Half of the people were gone. And they didn't know that in the very next room was an entire banquet set up. I want to tell you what, the same thing is offered to each and every one of us here today. We might be in our little room and we might experience God just a little bit. We might be talking about Jesus some. We may have even said the sinner's prayer. And we may have been baptized and we may be still confined to the little room that God has got us in for the appetizers. And we're having little sips of drink or whatever that we want. And then we walk away. But I'm here to tell you this morning that God's got another room with an entire banquet ready for each and every one of us to enjoy. Everybody in this place. He set the banquet table. Cleveland's going to come up now, and I think boys are going to, you're going to try to bring it up on the screen. And I want you to think about this. Think about this song that he's singing. It's the stone. And I don't know if you can get that or not, Irene. You might be able to. But I've been moved by this, and I think some real questions are answered in the lyrics of this song. If today is your day to come forward, the altar is going to be open. And what a day it could be. Can you imagine drawing a line in the sand, stepping across, come to the altar and saying yes to Jesus? Saying, yes, I want to go into the next room. I'm tired of just appetizers and sips on drinks. That's not what I want anymore. I want the full Monty. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. He's got something prepared for each and every one of us. Let's tap into it, folks. I know it's Easter Sunday, and I know it's Resurrection Sunday. But every day should be a resurrection day when you take a breath and can step out of bed. Love you guys.
Base my whole life on a book that was written. Sometimes troubles come, and they don't always go away way we want them to. If you just let the Lord take control of your life, well, He will make it all good as new. Jesus is waiting for you to understand. He holds the key in the palm of His hand. Maybe you've been told most of your life He was just another ordinary man. Give a blind man back his sight. If you could watch the dead man come alive, I'm sure you'd change your mind. And if you could have been there on that day when Mary to the grave, if you could have seen the look upon her face when she found out. Well, that the stone was rolled away. Yes, it was rolled away.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we go out in your workforce this week, Lord, just give us the strength to know what you went through on that cross on this day. Let us spread the word of goodness that you've given to us in this place, in our hearts. And just know that you're with us every step of the way. No matter where we go, you are there, Lord. We ask this in your heavenly Son's name, to you that died on the cross for our sins, Lord. And everybody said,
Amen.